As they make it in, go ahead and give it up for Mike again. Who knew we could sing like that? That was awesome. Good job, Micah. All right, for those that may not know, I'm Eric Miller. I am the youth pastor here, and you have arrived to Youth Sunday at Antioch. I just want to say welcome. Sit back and enjoy. Service is going to look a little bit different today, but we are all here to worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. No matter how worship looks, that is our main goal and purpose. But before we move into our congregational hymn today, you really don't have a bulletin. You have some notes and a couple songs that are on the back. Songs will be also on the screen. So sit back and enjoy and just go with the flow of worship. But I do need to take the time to embarrass a couple people. First, Tyler Clark, if you don't mind, go ahead and standing up, please, sir. Hang on. Wait. Candace Gentry, go ahead and stand up. Candace, where you at? There you are, right up front. Yep. And then Nancy Durham, Is Nancy in the house today? There she is back there. Everybody on the count of three, I hope this is no indication of how the service is going to go today, but their birthday is today, so on the count of three, everyone yell happy birthday. One, two, three.
Happy birthday!
Everyone join us. We're singing the song Fierce.
So stand up. Maybe, just a thought.
We need the song. Where?
I got this.
It's up here.
Okay.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for everything you do for us. I pray that we will just have an amazing time worshiping you and singing unto you today, dear Lord. I pray that the message will be amazing and that we'll all learn something from it. And I pray that you'll bless this day and the rest of the week. Amen. Okay, time to dismiss for Children's Church. Ages 3 to 3rd grade, head on out. And don't forget, we'll learn a lot and have a great time while doing it. That was for you, David.
Good morning. My name's Andrew Birch, if you didn't know that, and I'll start off with the announcements. There will be a Mission Possible Race fundraiser for our Philippine mission team on Saturday, September 23rd. Please check the information in the parlor for registration. Antioch's 164th homecoming is just around the corner on Sunday, September 17th. We will have one of our very own Reverend James Fortner to share God's word with us, followed by a covered dish luncheon. If you would like to decorate a table in the fellowship hall, please check the list in the parlor. And remember, all new class teachers and officers begin the new church year next Sunday, September 3rd. Deacons note, we will also have a meeting that morning. Thanks in advance to all who will serve the Lord faithfully on the Antioch team. Thank you.
Good morning. Reach over and greet your neighbors, please. Ethan, will you please have an offertory prayer?
Okay. Dear Lord, thank you for this beautiful Sunday. I pray for you to bless this offering. In your name I pray, amen.
Amen. Hi everyone, I'm Tyler. I want to share with y'all some of the things that God has impacted, some of the ways that God has impacted my life. So when I was 12, I got saved. I knew that Jesus died for me, and I knew that he was the ultimate sacrifice, but I didn't really get that I had to build on my relationship with him. So I wasn't focused on that. I was focused on making temporary friendships instead of taking the advantage of the eternal one that I already had. This continued for years, and to be honest, it was easy to play Christian. It wasn't until I found out what the word Christian meant that I decided to really give myself a Christian evaluation. Christian means little Christ or Christ-like. I wasn't acting very Christ-like. Instead of a true Christian, I was acting what I like to call a quote-unquote religious person. But disregarding the facts, I passed it off and said things like, of course I'm a Christian, I'm saved. But I know now that being saved is just the first step to being a Christian. A couple weeks ago, I went to camp. It was truly eye-opening. I always thought that one of the roles of being a Christian was us searching for God. But I was wrong. It's really God searching for us. He wants us. He wants to wrap us in his love. I realized this during worship time at camp. So that Thursday night, I decided to rededicate my life to Christ. I was tired of living a lie, and I was tired of running from God. Before my rededication, I wouldn't say that my heart was dead, but it was barely beating. Worship was my kickstart, and I'm excited to be able to worship with y'all this morning. And let me just go off on a little tangent. So, I've realized a lot that worship isn't just standing reading words off of a book. Worship is praising your King because he is the King of Kings. Worship is about letting the Holy Spirit move through you. So instead of just standing there, reading the words off of that book, or just singing with us on these slides, really involve yourself into the music, into the message. So I encourage everyone, again, not to listen to the music, but the message that's in the songs. I'm excited about how far God has brought me thus far, and I can't wait to find other ways to show him through me and through our other youth. Thank you, guys.
It hasn't always been this way. I remember brighter days before the dark ones came, stole my mind, wrapped my soul in chains. Now I live among the dead, fighting voices in my head, hoping someone hears me crying in the night and carries me away. Set me free. Crying in the rain, all alone with my demons, I am. Who is this man that comes my way? The dark ones shriek, they scream his name. Is this the one they say will set the captive free? Set me free. Yeah. I'm a free.
Well, I hope that you are enjoying Youth Sunday. For those that showed up today and didn't know it was Youth Sunday, God bless you, and thank you for staying and not walking out the back door. Get some feedback, Drew. Go ahead and grab your Bibles, and you can open up to Matthew chapter 14. So you have this handy red sheet in your hands, hopefully. If you don't, look on with your neighbor if you'd like to. But it's a quick outline. I challenge you every time I preach for Youth Sunday, or really any time I preach at all, to engage with God's Word. I hope that you've pulled your Bible out. I hope you are flipping to Matthew 14 right now. Also on that red sheet, there is space for notes. It kind of has 3 points outlined for what I'm going to talk about today. And I encourage you to jot notes and write things down. Nothing gets me more excited than going to camp or going to worship or going to the Go Conference and seeing my young people take out their journal and draw and write notes because it's much more meaningful. It sticks with you. And then when you forget, like I do and probably most of you guys do, you can go back and pull out those notes later and refresh your mind, because most of us come and sit in these pews on Sunday morning, and once we get started back to our life on Monday or even Sunday afternoon, what we have heard and what we have been taught quickly leaves our mind. So I encourage you to jot notes and then refresh your memory throughout the week as you move through week and as you move through life. So let's open up in prayer before we jump into the passage this morning. Thank you, Jesus, so much for your love for us. Thank you for this body of believers, Lord. What you're doing here at Antioch, it excites me to look behind me and see 30 or 40 teenagers here just worshiping you, praising you, in a packed sanctuary, Lord, for those that are here today, ready and eager to learn, to hear your word preached. Lord, I pray that you would bless each of us, bless the words that are about to come out of my mouth, help them make sense and help them be applicable to our lives, Lord. Help us to understand faith and fear, Lord, and both of those are realities in life, Lord, but I pray that our faith would greatly outweigh our fear, and I pray that your word would illustrate that point today and give us reassurance to who you are, the fact that you are Lord and God, you are our Savior, our Redeemer, and that you love us and care about us. It's in your name I pray. Amen. So we're going to start this morning looking at Matthew chapter 14, and we're gonna look at verses 22 through 33, and this is a passage that most of you are probably familiar with. Hopefully you've heard it preached before, but I'm going to try to open this passage up in a new light this morning and kind of expound on what Jesus is showing us and telling us within this passage and how we see him working in the disciples' lives, and hopefully open it up in a much greater extent than maybe you've ever heard it before as we talk about a theme today of a faith that is greater than fear. Now, we took a camp a few weeks ago to West Virginia. This was kind of a theme of camp, and so this is the theme throughout this passage, and I want you to think about the fears in your life and your faith, and do you let your fears dominate your faith, or do you let your faith outweigh your fears? So let's look at God's word. Verse 22. Immediately he made the disciples get into a boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. And after he had dismissed the crowds, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was there alone. But the boat by this time was a long way from the land, beaten by the waves, for the wind was against them. And in the fourth watch of the night, he came to them walking on the sea. But when the disciples saw him walking on the sea, they were terrified and said, "It is a ghost." And they cried out in fear. But immediately Jesus spoke to them, saying, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." And Peter answered him, "Lord, if it is you, command me to come to you on the water." And he said, "Come." So Peter got out of the boat and walked on water and came to Jesus. But when he saw the wind, he was afraid and beginning to sink. He cried out, "Lord, save me." Jesus immediately reached out his hand and took hold of him, saying to him, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt?" And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased, and those in the boat worshipped him, saying, "Truly, you are the Son of God." So today, we're going to look at the idea of fear versus faith, or faith versus fear. But I want to tell you the main objective of this passage we see at the end of this short narrative. And then we find it in verse 33, and it says, "And those in the boat worshipped him, saying, 'Truly, you are the Son of God.'" Jesus' whole point and Matthew's whole point in telling this story is for us to recognize who Jesus is. Jesus is not just some ordinary man that came and lived on the earth for 33 years and then left. Jesus came with a specific message, with a specific purpose, and he was sent by a specific person, and that was God. He was God's son, and he wanted his disciples to understand that. And we often miss this point or this part of the passage because we see Peter doing something amazing. We all want to focus on Peter walking on the water, and we want to get caught up in that. And we miss the point that Jesus is trying to teach his disciples that, hey, look, I want you to recognize who I am. I am God's son, and this is vitally important for you guys to understand. And so I want to put that in context today and why Jesus was making this point through that and illustrate Jesus' knowledge and his control over all situations. He set this whole scenario up to prove this point. And sometimes we don't want to look at this and think about this, but Jesus at the beginning of the passage said immediately he sent the disciples to the boat. He also sent them into the storm. And we don't want to think about Jesus purposely sending us into the storm. We don't want to think about Jesus that way. We don't want to look at life that way. But sometimes Jesus, or I'm going to tell you all the time, Jesus has a point for the storms. I heard Furtick say it earlier this week. He said, we see trouble. We see the life and we see the problems in life as trouble, but Jesus sees it as training. Are you looking at your troubles as training, as purposeful situations that God is going to use? And that's what he is doing with the disciples right now in this boat. That is why he walks on water. That's why he allows Peter to walk on water, because he wants to teach them a point. And if you don't recognize the context of this passage, if you don't explore this passage in the other Gospels, you may miss it. And so this morning, I'm going to take you on a quick journey through that to give you the context of that and for you to see the full picture of what Jesus is trying to say and the importance of understanding the breadth of Scripture and why the point of him being God's son is so important. So now, flip with me to Mark chapter 6. We're going to look at Mark chapter 6 and we're going to look at John chapter 6. And I'm going to read part of this, but I'm also just going to give you a brief overview of the context that we find here, because this story is in three Gospels. It's in Matthew, it's in Mark, and it's in John. And it's set in the middle of two big events. And so the first event, most of you hopefully have heard about or know of heard or have been taught this before, but it is the feeding of the 5,000, where we see a little boy with a Hebrew Happy Meal that is then divided, and it feeds 5,000 people, plus women and children. So you're really talking about a whole lot more people than that. But in Mark, I want you to look at verse 52 real quick. And so they had just seen Jesus perform this miracle, again, with the loaves and the fish. And verse 52 says, "For they did not understand about the loaves, but their hearts were hardened." He was pointing to the disciples. And he was pointing to the people that there were saw the miracle and realized that they did not understand, that their hearts had been hardened to what they had seen and could not fully comprehend what was taking place. So we note that. We don't see that in Matthew's version, but that's important to understand where the heart of the disciples were. And we're going to see what happens. If the disciples had just left from the feeding of the 5,000 and went on to the next section that we're getting ready to talk about, and their heart was hardened, they were going to be in trouble because they're about to be tested. They're about to be, something's about to be thrown in their face, and they've got to respond in a specific way. And we're going to see that, and we want to make sure, Jesus wanted to make sure that the disciples were prepared for that test. So we see that our hearts were hard. Now turn with me to John real quick, chapter 6, John chapter 6. And so Jesus, again, has multiplied the Hebrew Happy Meal. And then he sent the disciples on the boat and said, immediately get on the boat and go to the other side. And then we see Jesus leaving, and then they come to the other side of the lake. And so the next day, all these people that had just been fed are now coming to look for Jesus. And Jesus then proceeds to teach and goes all Hannibal Lecter on them and says, look, you're going to have to, if you want to be my disciple, you're going to have to eat my flesh and drink my blood. Now, that's some heavy stuff right there. I mentioned this in graduation Sunday. Jesus likes to scare people away once he gets a bunch of followers that are there for the wrong reason. he throws something out that is very radical and very different, and oftentimes kind of nerve-wracking or gut-wrenching, and it kind of checks where you are and what you're truly there for. And so he says, hey, look, this is what it's like. I am the bread of life. And in order to come to me and in order to accept me, you're going to have to drink of my blood and eat of my flesh. And so people started like, I don't know about this guy. It's a little crazy. Let's just go ahead and head on. I don't want some fish and loaves that bad. Let's take off. And so if we look at verse 66, we're going to see the disciples and their response. So verse 66 in John 6. It says, after many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him, so Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and come to know that you are the Holy One of God. When did they figure that out? Huh? When they left the feeding of the 5,000, their hearts were hardened. They didn't know. They weren't quite sure. They didn't know what was going on. But man, then came the boat at night, and Jesus set the stage for the Bread of Life sermon and the challenge that they were about to face. So we see this, and we see how Jesus, his ability to control everything, to see everything, to know everything, and to be very purposeful in life. So he sent them on the boat for a reason. We see in verse 22, he says, immediately he made the disciples get into the boat and go before him to the other side while he dismissed the crowds. Another point that he made in John that I forgot to touch on, but another thing that the crowds were wanting to do at this point in time was to make him king. They were like, hey, look, this guy just fed us with very little. He can provide what we need, so let's go ahead and crown him king. And Jesus didn't come to be king. Jesus came to be Savior. And he didn't want his disciples, who already had hardened hearts, to be tricked by the crowd, to get caught up in the mob mentality and be like, oh, man, these guys want to make him king. I guess that's Jesus' purpose. Let me go along with the crowd. So Jesus said immediately, you 12, you go get in the boat and get out of here, because y'all aren't prepared for this yet. I've got to put you in a storm so you're ready and can truly recognize who I am the next day. So again, just seeing Jesus' omniscience, big word, I know, but all-knowing. Jesus knows everything, and he can direct our steps and teach us in the storms. And so, like I said, I taught this at camp in West Virginia a couple weeks ago. And as I was planning for the trip, we were going whitewater rafting. I knew we were going whitewater rafting. So we were rafting the New River. I want to see some hands in here. Who has ever been rafting before? Who's ever been rafting? All right, leave your hands up. Oh, wait. Leave your hands up if you've ever been on the New River, the Golly River, somewhere out west, or gone down Niagara. All right, all y'all other ones that just put your hands down, y'all did a lazy river. Let me tell y'all. Y'all say y'all went whitewater rafting, but you didn't go whitewater rafting. So we were on the New River, and there's a bunch of class fours and class fives, and it was so dramatic that Carter Hall couldn't even stand the raft more than 20 minutes. We went over the first rapids, and out pops Carter, and we had to fish him back in, but he survived, and I think he's actually the only one that fell out throughout the day. But we were riding like roller coaster waves. Me and Carter were in the front of our boat, and there were several times I think I ended up in Carter's lap. But we were going out, and we had like 5-foot waves up above us. So our raft would go down, and we would be covered in water. And it would do that at least 3 different times within one rapid. So it was like you were on a roller coaster. It was pretty wild. But we had a blast, but it set up a perfect example of how to teach these kids about who Jesus is. It gives us just a glimpse of how Jesus is all-knowing and in control in all situations. So we talked about our God, and for those that have either been down a lazy river or real rapids, whatever you want to call it, you typically have somebody in the back of your boat. It's called the guide. And so this guide has been up and down the river a bunch of times. I think our guide said in order to be able to be a guide out on the New River, he had to do the river 30 times before they would allow him to guide a boat. And so these guides, he would tell you before coming up, we'd stop and he'd be like, okay, there's a rapid up here. There's some rocks there. There's some rocks there. We got to go this way in order to get through it. And if you fall out, if you want to save your life, you need to swim either right or left. And so he coached us. He told us how to paddle. He told us whether to go forward, whether to go backwards, how many times we needed to paddle in order to navigate those rapids just right. And that is much like Jesus in our lives. If we didn't listen to that guide, we would have gone whichever way we thought was best. We would have ended up flipping the raft, going down the rapids the wrong way, crashing our head on rocks, and all of us would have been out of the raft, and the raft would have been down the river, and we would have been struggling to swim. Thank goodness they gave us helmets and life jackets when we got on there, or else we probably would have been in trouble. So, but this is like Jesus, guys. This is like Jesus. But Jesus, let me tell you, is the better guide, because Jesus also controls the river. Isn't that something? Our guy couldn't control the river. He could read the river. He could tell us how to navigate it, but he really had no way of knowing if something was going to come up that was different than he had seen in the past. But Jesus is the better guide. Jesus knows what he's doing, and he can control the river the way he wants to. Be assured of that as we look at the concept of trust today. The disciples had hardened hearts. They left the feeding of the 5,000 not fully trusting in who God is. And so he sent the disciples into the storm to get their hearts right. Anybody ever been there before? Your heart's in the wrong place, so God is going to put you in a storm to get your heart right. I think that's happened to most of us in our life at some point in time or another, whether we want to admit it or not. But within the storm, we got to see this. We got to see Jesus shows us and he tells us that we can trust him. Look at these two parts. First, he tells us, as he walks up, immediately Jesus spoke to them. As they are crying out in fear, he says, "Take heart, it is I. Do not be afraid." Jesus tells us that we don't need to be afraid. We don't need to fear because it is Jesus. "I am God's son, and you're about to see that I am God's son. It is I. Do not be afraid." And then he goes on to show them. And in verse 32, it says, "And when they got into the boat, the wind ceased." He not only told them that, hey, look, you don't need to be afraid, but let me show you why you don't need to be afraid, because I am going to stop this wind. And if y'all have ever been out on a lake or an ocean or something, sometimes we think, oh, it's the waves, man. We're scared of the waves. The waves are what causes the problem. But the waves are only waves because of the strength of the wind. And until the wind stops, the waves aren't going to stop. And so Jesus quieted the wind. He quieted the storm. He showed them that they could trust him by telling them and by showing them. So I want to challenge you today to think about, what are you scared of? What in life has you beat down? What has you nervous? What are you holding on to so tightly that you can't let Jesus control it? Jesus said, "Don't be afraid. I am God's son. I am in control, and you can trust me." And because we often don't trust, we lack the next thing, and that's obedience. And obedience is tough, especially with these guys. And you parents out there, y'all are probably like, man, just preach them on obedience all the time. Just tell them, obey, 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 because that is something they do not get. And I've got a 3-year-old and a 4-year-old at home, and I feel you. I can tell them something 3 or 4 times, and it's either going in one ear out the other, or it's just hitting its ear and bouncing off. Because they don't get it. They don't listen. They don't obey. And it's been a constant struggle to get them to do what they know they need to do. So why is it hard for us as Christians to do that? Why can't we obey? It sounds easy. We all understand the concept of obedience. We all go to work. We all go to school. We all get in our car and drive. We know there's expectations. We know there's rules. We know there's things in place. And yet we often buck the system. And if we're bucking worldly systems, we're going to buck godly systems. We're going to buck God, and we're going to try him and push him, and we're not going to do what we're supposed to do. So I want to talk about 3 things today about why we don't obey. I want you to write these things down. We have limited insight. One, the first thing is we have limited insight. We are selfish. And we reject Jesus' lordship. We have limited insight of who Jesus is, just like the disciples did. The disciples had been hanging out with Jesus for a while. They'd seen Jesus do miracles. They'd just seen Jesus take some fish and loaves and feed thousands of people, yet their hearts were hardened. They didn't see the big picture. They didn't understand who Jesus was. They didn't understand the real purpose and why Jesus came. They had limited insight over who Jesus was. And we often live our lives with that kind of insight. We don't trust Jesus to work things out at work. We don't trust Jesus to work out our marriages. We don't trust him in our finances because we don't believe he can. We don't have that insight into how big Jesus is. And I want y'all to see that in this passage, that he saw this. He saw the need of this, and he sent them into that to give them insight. We are selfish. We like what we like, and we want what we want. And we're not willing to give it to Jesus. We're not willing to follow Jesus' plan to allow him to guide us because we follow our own agenda and our own wants and our own needs. And we see the disciples, though, with obedience. The disciples were probably confused. They had just seen a bunch of people fed, and Jesus is like, whoa, 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 you 12, y'all get in the boat right now. And the disciples, I'm hoping this is the case. That's what they did. They got in the boat. They didn't seem to hesitate. They didn't ask Jesus, well, why not? Man, we got a bunch of people here. You just fed all these people. Let's just hang out for a while. My belly's full. You just actually gave me a basket of bread and fish to take with me. Why do I got to go get in that boat? But they did. Jesus said immediately, he saw what was ahead and he needed them to listen and get in the boat. And then we reject Jesus' lordship. A lot of Christians today want to see Jesus as their savior, but they maintain the lordship over their life. They don't allow Jesus to take that commanding presence, to be the authority. They want to take the cross and say, yes, I'm forgiven. I'll take that grace, but I don't want to take your lordship. They don't want to let him rule over you because it goes back to that selfishness. And the world tells us that that's not possible. The world says Jesus couldn't really exist. There's not really a God. You be your own self. You be your own person. You live life the way you want to live life. Don't worry about that because this whole God thing is not really real. That's what y'all are really going to get pressed with, guys. The world is going to continually tell you that religion is a sham, that God doesn't exist, and you be your own person. And so when we believe that and we think God is a sham and that he doesn't care about us or there's no God up there that loves us, then why don't we just do our own thing? Why don't we follow our own selfish desires and live in disobedience? I want you to think about that. I want you to think about obedience and your perspective on obedience really quick. What in your life right now rules your choices and your decisions? If you lack the perspective that God is so big, that God can see things that you can't see, that God has insights into your problems, and that he may put you into a storm or he may bless you for a specific reason, do you view it as that? And if you view it as that, are you obeying? Are you obeying in all things like we see the disciples obeying? Again, they probably weren't quite sure why they had to go get in the boat so quick, but they had to. Jesus feared for them because he saw their hearts were hardened. He didn't want them roped into the mentality that he needed to be king because that's what everybody else was saying around them. He knew what they needed, and he told them to go, and they went. And we see the benefits of that. And so lastly, let's touch on faith real quick. I thought I was going to get you guys out of here on time, but it is 12 o'clock, and I apologize, but just sit back and enjoy God's word this morning. Hebrews 11:1 describes faith. It says, now faith is assurance of things hoped for and the conviction of things not seen. And so say, so, well, how do we see faith in this? Where does faith come in? I want you to think about Peter for a second and the disciples on the boat. Faith is believing in something you can't see. The disciples were scared in the boat because they saw something out on the water. They weren't sure what it was. All they could see was a shadow, and you know what they thought it was? They thought it was a ghost. They couldn't make it out clearly. There's no way that they thought that Jesus would have been walking on water. They couldn't see clearly, and so they did not believe. They weren't quite sure what they were looking at. And so Jesus shouts out and says, take heart, it is I, do not be afraid. So we see the disciples being in a position where they're not sure who Jesus is. We don't get the luxury the disciples had of walking side by side with Jesus. But we do have the presence of the Holy Spirit, and that lives within all believers. We can see Jesus. We should be able to feel Jesus. We should be able to hear Jesus just like the disciples did through that Spirit if we're seeking that out. So strengthen in your faith. How can we strengthen our faith in a world that is so against faith, that preaches that there is no reason for faith and you need to believe only what you can see and touch? I'm going to give you three more points. I'm big on three if y'all couldn't tell that today. But first, we need to rest in His presence. We need to rest in His presence. There was fear because Jesus was not in the boat. The disciples weren't sure what was going on, and they cried out in fear. They were terrified because they lacked Jesus' presence. And so what does Peter do? He says, hey, Jesus, if it's really you, call me, and I'm going to come to you. I'm going to walk on this water, I guess. I don't know if that's what he thought was going to happen or not, but Jesus says, come on. And Peter gets out of the boat and walks to Jesus. But then we see Peter start to sink, and we like to pick on Peter, man. Peter gets a bad rap. We're like, oh, man, he's sinking. He lacked faith. What's Peter's problem? How many of y'all would have even gotten out the boat? I don't think most of y'all would. The other 11 sat on their little hindies and like, bye, Peter. I don't know what you're doing, but you're walking on the water. Okay, you're going to drown. You know you can't swim, right? And so Jesus reaches out and grabs Peter when he says, Lord, save me. Save me. And Jesus grabs his hand. And look, most of us, we want to think Jesus took him back to the boat real quick, like, but he didn't. Jesus wrapped his arm around Peter. This is what I can imagine anyway. Jesus wraps his arm around Peter. Where at? Not in the boat. In the middle of the storm. Get that, guys. Jesus wraps his arm around Peter in the middle of the storm and encourages him. Why did you doubt? He didn't rebuke him. He coached him. Why did you doubt? Where's your faith? I'm right here. You know who I am. I'm walking with you. I'm back in your presence. We want Jesus to immediately take us out of the storm. We don't want Jesus to coach us in the storm, but this is what we see with Peter. I think that's a beautiful picture of the waves crashing and the wind blowing and Peter standing there still on the water with Jesus and Jesus speaking into his life. Allow Jesus to speak into your life during the storms. Don't just ask Jesus to take you out of it. Ask him to show you his presence in the storm. And that's where we've got to rest, in his presence. He then takes Peter and takes him back to the boat and then calms the storm. Rest in his presence, but be assured that Jesus is there in the storm and out of the storm. And sometimes you have to let him wrap his arm around you in the storm. Be prepared for that. We've got to listen. We're in a culture that is so focused on multitasking, so focused on doing more than one thing at a time that we don't listen. I tell you, I was in a room with a bunch of teachers the other day, and I'm going to knock my teachers because I work with a bunch of teachers, so I'm going to give them a hard time today. And we thank teachers. Anyway, I do. I'm like, man, teachers are good. They got to listen because what do? They stand up in front of class every day and say, you guys need to listen. Well, they were doing a training, and the instructor of the training says, okay, y'all need to pick somebody in this database other than this one, other than the one I'm using. And she said that at least three times, and I guarantee there was at least five people in that room of like 20 people that picked that person she said don't. They weren't listening. They were so focused on doing what they were doing that they went ahead and didn't filter what she was saying. And we are so guilty of that in life that we don't listen. We don't listen to each other. We don't listen to our family. We don't listen to instructions being given from the pastors. We just tune into what we want to tune into and tune out the rest of the world. And I am so guilty of this. The other night, I look back on this conversation. Kimberly Brooks is not here today, but she caught me after Wednesday night, and we were down there in the kitchen, and she was talking about small group and what God had laid on her heart. And you know what I was doing while she was telling me all this? I was grabbing vegetables out of the refrigerator and sorting through vegetables and listening to her. And I should have stopped. I should have gave her my ear. She had something very important on her heart that Jesus was trying to speak to her through, and she was wrestling with it. And I didn't take the time to stop and listen. We are all so guilty of that. We neglect relationship for our phones or for the media or a task at hand because we feel like those things are much more valuable than people. We often value tasks more than people, and we often value life more than relationship with Jesus. We get so busy with life, so focused on life, that we forget that Jesus needs to be a part of it. We forget to pull Jesus in and let him talk and speak into our life. We don't listen to what Jesus is trying to tell us. He has his word right in front of us. He has given us his Holy Spirit, and he has given us the opportunity to reach out in prayer. Prayer is nothing but a conversation with God. Conversation isn't one way, guys. It's both ways. God is going to speak back to you if you'll just listen. So we need to rest in his presence. We need to slow down and take time to listen. And last of all, we need to worship. Worship is huge. This is the major point within this passage, verse 33. And Jesus' reason for putting these disciples on the boat, for having Peter walk on water, he needed them to see who he was. And it says, and those in the boat worshiped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. And so as disciples are leaving the next day, they have been in worship with Jesus, and they recognize who he is, and they say, where else am I to go? You have the words of eternal life. You are who you say you are. Do y'all come in here just to hang out, to socialize and talk, or do y'all come to worship with your Creator? Tyler spoke to that, and I get so motivated by camps like Fuge, because we go there and we are in an auditorium with 1,000 other teenagers, and they are rocking. They got arms in the air. They got people dancing. They're jumping around. They're singing. They're shouting, and they are having fun, but at the heart of the matter, they are worshiping. Do y'all worship? Do you worship Jesus in your life? Do you worship Jesus at church? Do you worship Jesus at work? Think about that. If you want to grow your faith, you've got to be in worship. Worship doesn't just take place here on Sunday morning. It's not just trudging through some hymns or taking a few notes or opening your Bible when Dave gets up here to speak. Life is about worship. If you believe that Jesus is who he says he is, you would worship like the disciples worship. So in closing today, I want you to think about that. Do you allow fear in your life to outrule your faith? Or do you let faith strengthen your desire to follow Jesus and put your fears to the side? We see how Jesus moved within this story. We see how he moved within the disciples' lives. Allow Jesus to work. Allow Jesus to teach you when you don't feel like you know what's going on. And even when you feel like you know what's going on, Jesus might have something different planned for you. Are you trusting him? Are you obeying him? And are you strengthening your faith? Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, so much for your word. Thank you for the truth that we find in your word. Thank you for just being God. If we would truly take a step back and think about how big you are, how grand that is, and what that truly means to say, hey, look, you are the Son of God, Jesus. Help me worship. Help me be excited to obey. Help me trust you in everything. I pray this morning that you would continue to encourage your people, encourage this body of believers to grow their faith. Don't let fear dominate their life, but let faith rule. It's in your name I pray. Amen. The altar's open. We're going to sing, Come to the Altar. You're welcome to come down and pray. Stand and join us in worship. Thank you. thank you guys so much for being here today. I love and appreciate y'all. Thank you for speaking into the youth's lives. Thank you for your support here at Antioch. I can't say how grateful I am to be here. You need the mic? All right, I'm going to turn it over to Dave, and then he's going to give me back the mic before he gets done.
Real quickly, before we exit, y'all need to know that they would give God all the glory, all the credit, but we are blessed. Let these young people know how much you love them and appreciate them for what they've done in worship today for us. Please. And I'm going to go ahead and speak into this before you pick up the phone and call me. Don't bother. Don't bother to call me and tell me what you didn't like today. Don't. Because we're not going to have that conversation. What I want you to do, if it bothered you, is ask God why. Because there was nothing here done that did not glorify the Almighty God today, and we are grateful for it. So that being said, and making my afternoon a little freer, if you've got something sincere to talk to me about, my phone is on. But right now, we have, or call Eric. Yes, just call Eric. I got plausible deniability. I knew nothing about today, so just call him. All right, but no, call me if you need anything. But come on over here, Cindy. Before we turn it back over to Eric and the youth, this is our sister Cindy Smith, and she comes knowing the Lord for, gosh, forever, for as long as she can remember. Yeah, well, for a long time serving the Lord, and if you've heard her sing, you know that she's been gifted to worship and praise the Lord as well. We have been very blessed to have her in the choir for some time, and you're going to hear more from her soon. Your bodyguard's coming. Yeah, come on. But she comes today after she and I spent a great deal of time talking in Gatlinburg and a couple of other little conversations. She comes wanting to be an official member of this church by statement. So I do present to you Miss Cindy Smith for membership. Look at how much they love you. Carol Eubanks gets the first because I do not desire to die today. I'll give Micah a second because that's his Gigi now. So, all in favor, amen.
Amen.
All opposed, same sign. I knew nobody. See, I did that just to prove to you it'd be unanimous, because we really don't care anyway if they disagree. But no. But that being said, it is unanimous. Anything you'd like to share, sister?
As David said, I have been a member of God's family all my life, and I am so looking forward to growing in faith with this Christian community and my church home now.
Amen. Welcome home, Cindy. And she's going to come back in just a moment, and you come by and love on her, shake her hand, hug her neck, welcome her to the family, and help her acclimate. She knows she just joined an imperfect bunch of knuckleheads. She gets that. I told her that. I always advertise us as such because we are. We are imperfect, but we love the Lord. We're going to love her socks off, prove it to her, and I'm going to turn it right back over to Pastor Eric, and you guys have a wonderful afternoon.
So I challenge you to go home tonight and reflect on how big our God is. Just how you see him controlling any and all situations. Remember, he is your God and he controls the river. Live with a faith that is greater than your fear. Drew's going to close us in prayer and then you guys are dismissed. Thank you all again very much. Didn't know that.
Let us pray. Father God, we just thank you again for the many blessings that you've bestowed upon us. Lord, thank you for what your son has done for us on the cross. Thank you, God, that we are able to live out our faith. And Lord, that we would pray that we would, that you would help us to get rid of the fears that help, that take that faith away. Lord, thank you for everyone that's here. Thank you for the youth and the ability for them to use their gifts today, God. Thank you for this worship, God. Thank you that we were able to worship you freely. Lord, we love you and we thank you. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Y'all have a good night.